આનંદમાં રહે છે. આ ગુજરાતને એવું આનંદમય બનાવવા, ખુશ બનાવવા એટલા માટે અમે નિર્ણય કર્યો છે કે જ્યારે પાકીટમાં ખોલે ત્યારે પાકીટમાં જોઈતા પૈસા હોય, જમવાની થાળી પીરસાય ત્યારે સરસ મજાનું જમવાનું હોય, બાળકો વિદ્યાર્થીઓ કોલેજ સ્કૂલ જતા હોય ત્યારે હસતા હસતા જાય, હસતા હસતા પાછા આવે, વેપારીઓ પોતાના કામ ધંધે જાય ત્યારે ખૂબ આનંદમાં રહે, ખુશીથી રહે, ખુશહાલ ગુજરાત, ખુશ રહે ગુજરાત. અને એ આશીર્વાદ અમે આપની પાસે માંગવા આવ્યા છીએ. ડોક્ટર સાહેબ એક વિદ્વાન અર્થશાસ્ત્રીની સાથે એક સરળ, સહજ અને એમ કહેવાય કે એવા પોલિટિશિયન છે કે જેને માટે ભારતના એકે એક નાગરિકને હૃદયમાં ખૂબ સન્માન હોય ત્યારે આપણે એમનું સ્વાગત કરીએ છીએ. આપ સૌનું ખરા હૃદયથી પ્રદેશ કોંગ્રેસ સમિતિ બધીથી હું આપને સ્વાગત કરું છું. ધન્યવાદ. જય હિન્દ, જય જય ગરવી ગુજરાત.
મેં શ્રી અશોક ગેહલોતજી સન્માનીય હમરે રાષ્ટ્ર કે નેતા કો આપકી ઓર સે વિનંતી કરતા હું કે એ હમે પ્રાસંગિક અપના ઉદબોધન કરે. પરમ સદે ડોક્ટર મનમોહનસિંહજી, પ્રદેશ કોંગ્રેસ કમિટી પ્રમુખ ભારતભાઈ સોલંકીજી, ક્રિયાશીલ સચિવ હર્ષવર્ધન સરકારજી, તમારે વરિષ્ઠ નેતા રાજીવ શુક્લાજી, પ્રમોદ તિવારીજી, અનિલ જોશીજી, સિંગલાજી, તમામ ઉપસ્થિત સમન્વય મંચ ઓર તમામ ઉપસ્થિત અમારે કેન્ડિડેટ જો બને હૈ યહાં પે ભાઈ ઓર બહેનો, નોજવાન સાથી, મુજે બહુ ખુશી હૈ કે ડોક્ટર મનમોહનસિંહજી આજ સુરત શહેર કે અંદર આપ ઉનસે પધાર રહે હૈ. મેં અપની ઓર સે આપ સબકે ઓર સબકે હાર્દિક સ્વાગત કરતા હું. મનમોહનસિંહજી કે બારે મેં અભી ભરતભાઈ કુછ બાતે કહી, મેં સમજતા હું કે પૂરા દેશ ઓર પૂરા વિશ્વ જાણતા હૈ કે મનમોહનસિંહજી કિસ તરહ કે વ્યક્તિ કે ધની હૈ. હમારે દેશ કો ગૌરવ હૈ કે મનમોહનસિંહજી જૈસા વ્યક્તિત્વ, ઉનકા કર્તૃત્વ દેખ કરકે દુનિયા કે બડે બડે મુલ્ક કે રાષ્ટ્રાધ્યક્ષ, પ્રધાનમંત્રી ભી બહુ પ્રભાવિત રહે. આપ લોકો યાદ હોગા જબ દેશ કે હાલાત બહુ ગંભીર થે, તબ સોના ગીરવી રખા ગયા હતા એ દેશ કા. ઉસ વખત મેં જબ સરકાર બની નરસિંહરાવજી થી, ડોક્ટર મનમોહનસિંહજી વિત્તમંત્રી બનાયા ગયે, એક નય દોર કી શરૂઆત થઈ, એક બદલાવ આયા દેશ કે અંદર, કિસ રૂપ મેં ઉદારીકરણ કી શરૂઆત કી ગઈ ડોક્ટર મનમોહનસિંહજી દ્વારા, ઉસકે બાદ કે હાલાત, દેશ મેં કઈ ઉતાર ચઢાવ ભી આયે થે, ડોક્ટર મનમોહનસિંહજી કે કાર્યકાલ મેં ચાહે વિશ્વ મેં મંદી કા દોર રહા હો, તબી સબસે કમ અસર દેખને કો મિલતા થા ઉસ દેશ કે અંદર. ઓર ઉસી કી બદોલત પે યહાં કે ઉદ્યમી હો, વ્યાપારી હો, આર્થિક વ્યવસ્થા હો, ઉસકો મેન્ટેન રખ લિયા ગયા, તકલીફો કા સામના નહીં કરના પડા. ઇનકા કાર્યકાલ ચાહે આર્મી ગવર્નર કે રૂપ મેં હો, ચાહે વિત્ત મંત્રી કે રૂપ મેં હો, અને પ્રધાનમંત્રી કે રૂપ મેં હો, ઇનકી આલોચના ભી કરને કે પ્રયાસ કિયે ગયે. તો મુજે કઈ લોકો ને કહા દુનિયા કે મુલ્કો કે અંદર એ બાકી ચર્ચા હૈ કે ડોક્ટર મનમોહનસિંહજી જૈસે વ્યક્તિત્વ કે બારે મેં કિસ પ્રકાર સે વ્યક્તિત્વ કો લેકર કે દુનિયા જાનતી હૈ વ્યક્તિત્વ કો, ઉનકે લેવલ કે અર્થશાસ્ત્રી હૈ ઉસકે બાવજૂદ ભી ये चुपने चुप की जाती है. और मनमोहन सिंह ने खुद ने कहा था कि आने वाले जमाने का इतिहास है वो न्याय करेगा. आप हम सबके देखते हुए ही आज पूरा देश जानता है कि इनके वक्त की क्या क्या उपलब्धियां थी, क्या क्या क्रांतिकारी फैसले किए गए, 10 साल के यूपीए कार्यकाल के अंदर, उनके जिक्र मैं नहीं करना चाहूंगा क्योंकि वक्त नहीं है, तो इतना कहना चाहूंगा अब इतना जल्दी ही जो माहौल बनाया गया था अच्छे दिन आएंगे, ब्लैक मनी आएंगे, 2 करोड़ लोगों को रोजगार देंगे नौजवानों को, पता नहीं क्या क्या वादे किए गए, जैसे कि आकाश से तारे तोड़ के ले आएंगे जमीन पर, कोई हालात आप देख लो, 4.5 साल कंप्लीट हो रहा है करीब करीब, पूरे देश के किसान हो, मजदूर हो, छोटे उद्यमी हो, छोटे व्यापारी हो, नौजवान हो, सब में निराशा की भावना पैदा हो गई है। उस स्थिति में चुनाव होने जा रहे हैं गुजरात के, मैं तो आपको उन पर ही अपील करना चाहूंगा कि एक बार बदलाव 22 साल के बाद में होगा। अभी तक तो मार्केट ही काम चल गया, वाइब्रेंट गुजरात का ऐसा नारा दिया गया, मैं खुद फॉलो कर रहा था जब मैं 20 साल पहले मुख्यमंत्री हूँ तब से, और बाद में जब मोदी जी बने प्रधानमंत्री तब से, तो वाइब्रेंट गुजरात के नाम से 1.5 करोड़ का इन्वेस्टमेंट, कुछ 5 करोड़ का, कुछ 7 करोड़ का इन्वेस्टमेंट आएगा, 10% इन्वेस्टमेंट भी नहीं आया होगा। तो मार्केटिंग अच्छी की गई, 22 साल निकाल दिए, अब हम आपसे अपील करते हैं कि कृपा करके इस बार आप एक बदलाव लाएं जिससे कि एनडीए गवर्नमेंट को झटका लगे, उनके मंत्रिमंडलों को झटका लगे, ये क्या हो गया गुजरात के अंदर, हो सकता है कि 1.25 साल बचा हुआ उनके पास में उस झटके से कुछ काम करके दिखा है। इसलिए मेरा मानना है कि गुजरात की जनता उपकार करेगी पूरे देश के ऊपर, एक नए निर्णय लेकर के बदलाव करके, और लोग मैं समझता हूं कि पूरे देश के अंदर गुजरात के चुनाव को देख रहे हैं कि गुजरात की जनता क्या फैसला करती है। इसलिए मैं आपसे अपील करना चाहूंगा कृपा करके इस बार आप लोग अपने प्रभाव का काम लें और कांग्रेस की गवर्नमेंट बनाएं, ये बात करता मैं अपनी बात समाप्त करता हूं। धन्यवाद, जय हिंद।
आप सब लोग, हम यही जानते हैं पूरी दुनिया कि स्वप्नद्रष्टा पंडित नेहरू और प्रियदर्शिनी इंदिरा जी के बाद डॉक्टर साहब ने तत्काल देश की कमान संभाली। पर दो बात आप नहीं जानते हैं, मोरारजी देसाई को जब 91 में पता चला कि वो फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर बने हैं तो उनके एक वर्ड थे कि नरसिंहराव जी ने बेस्ट पर्सन को फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर बनाया, दैट वाज हिज वर्ड। आप यहां के सुप्रीम कोर्ट के जज और लॉ कमीशन इंडिया के चेयरमैन धीरूभाई देसाई को सब जानते हैं, जब वो फाइनेंस मिनिस्टर बने तो फ्री इकोनॉमी के बारे में धीरूभाई देसाई ने आर्टिकल लिखे थे, वो बहुत खिलाफ थे उस विचार से। लेकिन जब डॉक्टर साहब के पास वो मिलने गए तो डॉक्टर साहब ने उनको इतना सम्मानित किया कि उनकी एक रिक्वेस्ट पर डॉक्टर साहब ने इंडिया की फर्स्ट लिक्विडेट टेक्सटाइल कंपनी को वर्कर्स कोऑपरेटिव बना दिया, इट वॉज द एग्जाम्पल। ये डॉक्टर साहब को बारे में पूरी दुनिया ने कहा कि 2004 के बाद ऑनवर्ड पूरी दुनिया इकोनॉमिक क्राइसिस में थी, तो एक ही नोबेल प्राइम मिनिस्टर ने इस क्राइसिस को इंडिया में संभाला, कंट्रोल किया और इंडिया को अच्छी तरह से दुनिया में आगे बढ़ाया। कि हम लोग नहीं, पूरी दुनिया, वर्ल्ड, इंडिया के बाहर के सभी रिनाउंड लोगों ने यह स्टेटमेंट दिया था। मैं डॉक्टर साहब को, जो रियल में हमारे मनमोहन है नाम से, क्योंकि उन्होंने ये साबित कर दिया था, ये प्रूविंग, कि आदमी बिना बोले विदाउट स्पीकिंग परफॉर्मेंस दे सकता है, और वो परफॉर्मेंस उन्होंने 2004 से लेके 10 साल उन्होंने दिया इकोनॉमी को और इंडिया को। डॉक्टर मनमोहन साहब, ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ ऑल ऑफ अस आई प्रे यू प्लीज गिव ब्लेसिंग एंड गाइडेंस टू दी दिस सूरत बिजनेस एंड ऑल कम्युनिटी। डॉक्टर साहब,
my esteemed friend Sri Ashok Janak Ji, Sri Bharat Singh Solanki Ji, Sri Harshvardhan, Secretary A.I. Sinte Ji, Sri Rajiv Shukla Ji, Sri Hathmukh Rehai Ji, leaders sitting on the dais, distinguished ladies and gentlemen. I am very happy to be amidst you in Surat, which is renowned world over for its diamond and textile industries. Gujarat state has produced India's most extraordinary sons, Mahatma Gandhi and Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. I am also happy to be in the state where one of my daughters obtained her degree at IRMA in Thane. Friends, I also understand that you have been through some very tough times over the last 1 year. Problems that was no creation of yours, and yet the people of Surat suffer. I come here to tell you that the Congress Party stands with you during this difficult period brought about by the government's double blow of demonetization and poor implementation of the GST. Most of you trusted our Prime Minister and believed in the policy of demonetization, in the hope that those suffering would actually benefit India. I salute your commitment to the cause of rooting out black money from our country. But soon it emerged that corruption remained unabated. Those who had black money were able to convert it into white. Just as you are recovering from one blow, then came the GST. Nobody consulted you or tried to understand how your dhandas work. The Prime Minister is from Gujarat. He claims to understand Gujarat and the poor more than anyone else. How is it that he never understood the pain his decisions will unleash on you? This is uninformed, half-faced crusade on black money, where he painted everyone to be a thief when the real culprit has gotten away. GST is a good idea, which the Congress initially supported, but the BJP government's version was poorly designed, badly implemented, and brought about in a tearing hurry. I am aware that many of the problems of last 1 year still remain, and we are committed to resolving them as much as we can as a responsible opposition. Your business works on trust and relationship. Without trust in each other, Surat will collapse. You extended this trust to the Prime Minister and his promise of bringing a change. The hope symbolized in those dreams now lies shattered. In Surat alone, 89,000 looms have been sold to scrap. That amounts to more than 31,000 workers losing their jobs the long part of the textile chapter below. There are countless such examples from industrial clusters and big mandis across the entire country. But I must state that I also speak with a heavy heart. I start my address by invoking the memories of more than 100 people who lost their lives last year standing in queues before our bank as a result of demonetization. It is more than 1 year since the disastrous policies of demonetization were thrust on the people of our country. I say with immense pain and a sense of deep responsibility that the 8th of November was a black day for our economy and indeed for our democracy. I remember feeling shocked when I heard the Prime Minister's announcement, and I wondered who advised him to inflict such a reckless step on our nation, and whether any considered thought did go into its make. My dear friends and fellow countrymen, black money and the tax evasion are no doubt in manner that the country needs to tackle and tackle effectively. But demonetization was clearly not the solution. It has been suggested many times in the past as one of the methods to eradicate black money. But as a responsible government, we never took such a drastic measure because in our reasoned analysis, the costs of demonetization always exceeded the benefits substantially. One must also remember that nowhere in the world has any democracy undertaken such a coercive move. Now, withdrawing 86% of legal tender in one single swoop. Neither would anyone advise to bring out an even more high-value currency notes of ₹2,000 after invalidating ₹500 and 1,000 notes. We know by now that none of the stated objectives of eliminating black money, terror financing, and controlling counterfeit currency have been met. To promote the less cash economy, coercive steps like demonetization are proving to be ineffective. The cash in circulation after 1 year has grown to 90% of the previous level. The fact that more than 99% of the demonetized currency came back into the banking system has punctured the government's claim. There are also widespread reports of the rich converting their black money into white while the poor suffered and suffered miserably. Demonetization has proved to be a mere bluster to reach political gains, while the real offenders have managed to escape. We saw the impact of demonetization on the economy when the GDP growth rate dropped to 5.7% in the first quarter of 2017-18. Under the new calculation. Even this is bound to be a gross underestimate as the pain of the informal sector is not adequately captured in the GDP calculation. Every 1% loss of GDP annually costs our nation rupees 1.5 lakh crore. Think of the human impact from this lost growth, the lost jobs, the youth whose opportunities have vanished, the businessmen who had to shut down, and the entrepreneurs whose drive to succeed has turned into discouraged disappointment. GDP growth in the first quarter of 2017-18 fell to 5.7%. July-September quarter this year has registered a growth rate of 6.3%. This is to be welcomed. But it is too early to conclude that this represents a reversal of the declining trend observed in the previous 5 quarters. Some economists of repute believe that the CSO, which released the figures day before yesterday, has not adequately captured the impact of demonetization and GST on the informal sector that accounts for about 31% of the economy. Commenting on the strong growth in the second quarter in manufacturing, Mr. Govinda Rao of the Center for Financial Analysis said, "There is our problem here. We are calculating manufacturing growth based on corporate reserves. This does not take into account the small and medium sector which suffered the most after demonetization and the launch of GST. A couple of big worries remain. The agricultural sector growth fell to 1.7% from 2.3% in the previous quarter and 4.1% in the same quarter last year. Ladies and gentlemen, we have to remember that this is despite the fact that the government has front-loaded its spending on projects, forcing up our fiscal deficit to a high of 96.1% of rupees 5,46,532 crore target set for the full fiscal year. This means that private spending on construction has been very difficult, said Pranab Sen, former chairman of the National Statistical Commission. After farming, I fear that the job losses have been the most pronounced in the construction sector. Incidentally, these two sectors are the largest sectors in terms of job creation. The financial sector grew by 5.7% in the second quarter of this year, far lower than 6.4% in the April-June quarter, and significantly lower than the 7% growth in the same period last year. Thus, ladies and gentlemen, there is still considerable uncertainty about the growth of our GDP. The Reserve Bank forecasts that growth in 2017-18 will pick up to probably 6.7%. However, even if growth reaches 6.7% in the fiscal year 2017-18, Modi's 4-year average growth rate will be still only 7.1%. To equal the UPA's 10-year average, the economy will have to grow at 10.6% in the 5th year. I would be happy if this were to happen, but frankly, I do not think it will. What is even more tragic is that none of the lessons from this monumental blunder have been learned by the government. Instead of providing relief And I requested in Parliament to the poor and marginalized farmers, traders, and small and medium businesses who suffered the brunt of demonetization the government chose to inflict on them a badly designed and hastily implemented GST. This twin blow is a complete disaster for our economy. It has broken the back of small and medium enterprises in Gujarat. The impact in the first rest of the country is equally bad, if not worse. The supply chains and credit lines of our MSME sector and industrial clusters have been greatly affected, hampering production. You are aware of the damage done to the ceramic sector in Morbi and the industries in Wapi and Rajkot. Overall, as our domestic sector is not able to cope with demand, China is benefiting from this situation. In the first half of fiscal year 2016-17, India's imports of China stood at rupees 1.96 lakh crore. During the same period of in fiscal 2017-18, imports from China have gone up to rupees 2.41 lakh crore. This unprecedented increase of imports by more than rupees 45,000 crore, which is a 23% increase in a year, can be attributed largely to demonetization and GST. These twin blows have damaged India's MSME sector, and our businesses had to turn to Chinese imports at the cost of Indian jobs. The goods and services tax, as envisaged by our UPA government, was forced to simplify taxation in the country with a single tax capped at 18% to make life easier for our businesses, both big and small. The current GST is a great departure from that vision. It has transformed into a complicated mess with multiple tracks and rates as high as 28% along with additional taxes. This was done by the government without paying any heed to our advice, both in Parliament and in private consultation. Compliance requirements have become a nightmare for small businesses. The unending notification and changes in rules, the repeat of the chaos of demonetization has caused needless confusion. Along with demonetization, GST has sown a deep-rooted fear of tax terrorism among the business communities all over our country. At a time when our economy has slowed down considerably, despite favorable global macroeconomic conditions, the fear of tax terrorism has eroded the confidence of businesses to invest. As you know, the growth in private investment is at a 25-year low. This is terrible for India's economy. My dear friends, good governance involves both the use of the head as well as the heart. It pains me to say that the Union government has completely failed to do its duty on both fronts. Let me explain through the example of two of the greatest sons of Gujarat the world has seen. The Mahatma, who represents the heart and soul of our nation, gave us a telescope. He said, and I quote, "Whenever you are in doubt, apply the following test. We call the face the poorest and the weakest man or woman whom you may have seen in the day, and ask yourself if the step you contemplate is going to be of any use to him. While he will he gain anything by it? Will it restore him to a control over his own life and destiny? In other words, will it lead to sura for the hungry and spiritually starving millions? Did the Prime Minister Haya stop to consider the wisdom of the Mahatma in asking the RBI governor to sign on the dotted line, or while implementing GST in saving pay? Did he think about the impact of those who died in the informal sector, whose earnings dried up overnight because of a shortage of cash? Did he think about the millions of people of India who lost jobs and had to return to their villages in the chair? If the Prime Minister had paid attention to Mahatma Gandhi's talisman, the poor of India would not have suffered the way they did. You know that I have seen crippling poverty while growing up as a child in Punjab before the partition. I have also seen the significant strides our great nation has taken in my lifetime, building on the foundation laid by Congress government from Pandit Nehru to Shastriji to Indiraji, Rajivji, Narasimha Raoji, and also by the government led by Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee. I can proudly say that when I was Prime Minister, we lifted 140 million people out of poverty, a task no other democracy in the world has achieved. Yet, even today, 1 in 2 Indians remain vulnerable, and one blow can make them fall back into poverty. Demonetization and GST are two blows that have probably pushed millions back into terrible hardship. So they had to turn to the social safety net provided by the MGNREGA, which was legislated by the UPA government. The other great Gujarati, who is an inspiration to us, is Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. He was the force behind uniting India from 565 disparate princely states to one united nation. When undertaking the endeavor of one nation, one text, if the Prime Minister had taken inspiration from the resolve and attention to detail of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, the outcome today would have been very different. Bravado and drama are poor substitutes for courage, disposition, and the ability to execute well. When we passed the nuclear deal in the UPA 1 regime, the intelligence and idealism of Pandit Nehru, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, and Indiraji was our guiding light in our endeavor to end the nuclear apartheid of India and ensure energy security for our country. We stood strong by our principles and even risked our government while the BJP opposed it vehemently. We got the world to change the rules of the nuclear regime in our favor. This is why the people of India supported us fully on the issue of the nuclear deal. Today, 1 year after demonetization, large sections of the country feel they have been taken for a ride by their government, that their trust has been betrayed. My friend, question must be asked again and again on the soundness of policy and lack of transparency in the government. It saddens me to see that every important issue that affects the lives of crores of citizens is being turned into binary of black and white. The Congress Party has built India into a global economic powerhouse over the past 70 years. We want to ensure that the national interest is uppermost and that the weaker sections of society are effectively protected. By questioning the bullet train, does one become anti-development? Is everyone who questions the outcomes of demonetization of GST a tax evader? Does questioning the drop in GDP rate make one an anti-national? This attitude of suspecting everyone to be a thief or an anti-national, the low-level rhetoric is damaging to the democratic discourse and has real consequences for how we relate to each other as citizens. Political leaders, I urge, must stick to the high road. Even every government builds on the foundations of the past and benefits from the efforts of the centre. Others can lay the foundations of the Sardar Sarovar Dam, and various Congress governments took it forward. Water poured into the Narmada main canal the year our present Prime Minister first became the Chief Minister of Gujarat. I also remember that the World Bank cut funding for the project. As Finance Minister of India, I stepped forward to provide immediate funding for the project. As we think of the benefits of farmers from the Sardar Sarovar project, we must also address their concerns about land acquisition. It was the Congress Party that ushered in a historic change in the form of the landmark right to fair compensation and transparency in land acquisition, reapplication and settlement act 2013, undoing a 123-year-old imbalance and injustice to the farmers. The objective was to ensure a humane, participative, informed and transparent process, resulting in least disturbance to the owners and making the affected person partner in India's development. This was inclusive growth with both head and heart in the right place. However, daily a year after coming into power, the NDA government sought to amend the law to take away the need for social impact assessment studies, rights to consent and rehabilitation, resettlement and other necessary safeguards such as public hearing of those affected. While the Congress under the leadership of Sonia Ji and Rahul Ji prevented this from happening, this Gujarat state government, another BJP run government, has amended the law at the state level, undermining the spirit of the national law. Is it any wonder that our farmers, brothers, continue to protest for injustice in these states? Our farmers are also suffering from extended agrarian distress, along with the impact of demonetization and depressed rural spending. The decline in real wages is apparent, while the BJP's whole promise of increasing the minimum support price has been betrayed. The loan waivers announced in a few states have only paid lip service to the farmers concerned. Similarly, our Adivasi brothers and sisters are being served. The Gujarat government has been the worst performer in settling claims and distributing title deeds to Adivasi and other forest dwellers as per the historic scheduled tribes and other traditional forest dwellers recognition of forest tribes act passed by the UPA government in 2008. While all over India, deeds have been disposed of at the rate of 87%, in Gujarat, the figure stands at 44%. Moreover, the Gujarat government has taken a very controversial decision to leave laws for selling forest land to industry. The Bottom Fourth District in rural development in Gujarat are the Adivasi districts of Dahod, Dang, Panchkulan and Banaskantha. On every social indicator, from infant mortality rate, maternity, maternal mortality rate, to female literacy, Gujarat has unfortunately fallen behind the best performing states of our country, including Himachal, Karnataka, Kerala, and Tamil Nadu. The abdication of the Gujarat state in shouldering its responsibilities for public education has led to rampant privatization and decreasing quality of education. This, in turn, is affecting the competitiveness of otherwise short Gujarati youth in the job market. Recent agitations of the youth cutting across different sections of society is an indication of the deep dissatisfaction with the performance of successive BJP governments in Gujarat. The winds of change are blowing all over Gujarat. The Congress Party will ensure that the voice of every Gujarati, regardless of caste, creed, gender, or art class, will be heard. Our Congress government will govern with both head and heart, with Sardar Patel and Mahatma Gandhi as our inspiration. After decades distant at the end, the time has come for the intelligent and enterprising people of this dynamic state of Gujarat to once again repose their faith in the Congress Party, which will work together with 6.5 crore Gujaratis to take the state to new heights and the future it rightly deserves. Jai Hind.
Thank you very much, Dr. Saab, for your great guidance and blessings. Now I request Praful Togariaji, our Corporation Congress leader, to say a vote of thanks. Avan. આપણા ભારત દેશના પૂર્વ વડાપ્રધાન માન્ય મનમોહનસિંહ, રાજસ્થાનના પૂર્વ મુખ્યમંત્રી અને ગુજરાતના પ્રભારી અશોક ગેહલોતજી, ગુજરાત પ્રદેશના પ્રમુખ શ્રી માન્ય ભરતસિંહ સોલંકી સાહેબ, એઆઈસીસીના સેક્રેટરી હર્ષવર્ધન સતકાલજી, પ્રમોદ તિવારીજી, રાજીવ શુક્લાજી, સુરતના અધ્યક્ષ હસમુખભાઈ દેસાઈજી, અને જેને આપણે સાંભળવા આતુર થયા હતા અને આપણે બધાને આપણે જીએસટીની, નોટબંધીની અને બધી વાત કરી અને સુરતના તમામ નાના મોટા ઉદ્યોગપતિઓ આવી અને જે વાત સાંભળી અને અમારા કોંગ્રેસ પક્ષની વાત તમે બધાએ સાંભળી બધા ખૂબ ખૂબ આભાર. થેન્ક યુ. ભારત માતાજી જય.
એક સેકન્ડ આપણી લઈએ જરા પ્લીઝ. દિનેશ કાછડિયા આપણા ઉત્તર વિધાનસભાના ઉમેદવાર છે. જિગ્નેશ મેવાસા કતારગામ વિધાનસભાના ઉમેદવાર છે. ભાવેશ રબારી આપણા કરંજના ઉમેદવાર છે. અને શ્રી ધીરુભાઈ ગજેરા વરાછાના ઉમેદવાર છે. નીતિન ભરૂચા આપણા પૂર્વના ઉમેદવાર છે, સુરત પૂર્વ છે. અને અશોક કોઠારી મજુરાના ઉમેદવાર. સભાનું કામકાજ પૂરું થાય છે. ડાક્ટર સાહેબ વિદાય લે એટલે આપણે બી નમ્ર વિનંતી.
સંવાદ નહીં હોગા ક્યાં? ઉચ્ચન અંતર સંવાદ નહીં હોગા ક્યાં?